And now it's time for the political analysis of Brooks and Capehart. That's New York Times columnist David Brooks and Washington Post columnist Jonathan Capehart. Mark Shields is away. So hello to both of you on this Friday night. I want to start with something both candidates did. They went to a city, David, that is where people are truly in anguish over the shooting of a black man. His name is Jacob Blake. It's Kenosha, Wisconsin. We saw both of them go make statements. What did you make, David, of their different approaches?
Well, they were both very true to their core vision, what they've been running on, especially this year, but maybe since the beginning of their political careers. Donald Trump has been running on a sense of menace, a sense that there's a lot of danger out there in the world and that he's the one to restore order. And so the keystone of his visit was the image of him standing behind in front of burned out buildings. And he wants to convey that message. Joe Biden has run as a uniter. And so he went to speak to the Blake family. He pleased them very much with his sensitivity to what they were going through. And you'd have to say the evidence so far is that the law and order campaign that Trump has been running since the convention has not shown much impact on the polls. He's still down 7 or 8 points. If you ask people on a whole range of measures, which candidate makes you feel safe, Biden wins on any way you ask that question, Biden wins. If you ask people, is Donald Trump making it worse, 55% say Donald Trump is making it worse. So the law and order message, at least so far, and as expressed through Kenosha, not working.
Jonathan, how did you see this?
Well, Judy, I look at it as at the two trips like this. One was a political, both were political trips, but one was political, the other was presidential. President Trump's trip was strictly political. To David's point, it was all about law and order. It was all about stoking fear, white grievance, white fear of black people, standing with law enforcement, which on its face is not wrong or bad or problematic, but in a city where a 17-year-old allegedly shot at three people, killed two of them, and those same police officers rolled right by him, the president has had nothing but good things to say about that person who was part of a militia, a right-wing militia. And so the president goes to Kenosha to, you know, buttress that. Joe Biden, on the other hand, I think did a presidential trip. He went to the Kenosha community to meet with the community, met with the Blake family, apparently talked with Jacob Blake. But the community meeting he did at a local church where he heard from all sorts of folks from the community was him sitting, listening, responding in kind. And a young woman, Portia Bennett, who decided not to read the list of demands from her organization, but instead decided to talk from the heart and talk to Vice President Biden about how, quote, heavily angry she and her community are about not being treated fairly. And the way Joe Biden responded to that, I think, was sort of a balm over the entire situation. Because in situations that happen, as have happened in Kenosha, people look to the president for calm, for leadership. They got that from Joe Biden, but Joe Biden isn't the president.
Well, we both candidates during this past week have released TV ads that address racial unrest, address protests around the police. Here's just a short clip from each one.
Rioting is not protesting. Looting is not protesting. It's lawlessness, plain and simple. And those who do it should be prosecuted. Fires are burning and we have a president who fans the flames. He can't stop the violence because for years he's fomented it.
Lawless criminals terrorize Kenosha. Joe Biden takes a knee. Biden and the radical left's weak response has led to chaos and violence. And their calls for defunding police would make it worse.
David, what do these messages tell you?
Well, Biden did something his party failed to do during the convention, which was to acknowledge that there is disorder in the country. Crime really is rising, and there has been rioting and looting. It's not the mainstream of the protests, but it's been an element of the protests. Maybe about 8% of the protests have turned violent. That's still a lot, and it's still on people's minds. And so with that speech and then the ad they've cut out of it, He's acknowledging that, and he's making a clear statement, which we talked about last week, of setting a boundary that rioting and looting are not protesting, and that he's going to crack down on that. And that was acknowledging a real flaw in the Democratic approach at the convention, where they just didn't see that reality. And so I think he helped himself. I mean, his team, the downside of his team is they're really experienced. They've been part of the Democratic Party for a long time. The upside of his team is they're really experienced, and they know how to run a campaign. I think they've run a very effective campaign straight through, and it showed again this week.
Jonathan, does that ad help Joe Biden?
I think that ad helps Joe Biden because he makes a clear line, which is obvious to folks on the ground, that there is a distinct difference between the peaceful protesters who are out there wanting their voices heard about what happened to Jacob Blake being shot in the back 7 times by police officers. That young woman I just mentioned, Portia Bennett, she even in her remarks said she was there speaking not for the not for the rioters and the looters. No, she is there speaking on behalf of the protesters who want equity. And I do think I agree with David, it is important and good that Vice President Biden put that ad out there and made it clear that he draws a line and a distinction. And I don't think he's reacting to President Trump as much as he's reflecting the reality on the ground and the reality as the protesters see it. They're not part of the rioters or the looters either.
Two other quick things I want to ask you both about. David, has to do with several announcements from the administration in recent days about rapid testing for COVID. The president talking about we're going to have a vaccine this fall, maybe in October. Is all this likely to be effective in changing the minds of voters who are skeptical about his leadership or just don't know what to think?
Well, willing a vaccine into existence like a week before the election, probably not going to work. It's not the way science works. But I have to give the administration some credit on the rapid testing. And the Abbott labs apparently come with a breakthrough that gives you a chance to do testing fast. And the administration has poured a lot of money toward that to get 150 million of these tests. And for all the flaws of the administration's COVID response, they've done a decent job of pouring money both toward a vaccine and toward testing. And so I give them some credit on that. From what I understand of this test, it's not the ultimate solution for testing. You want to be able to test at home and et cetera. But if we could do rapid testing, you could test as people go into schools and conferences and buildings. If that could be effective, that's a step back toward normalcy. And I have to give them some credit where credit's due. They've put a lot of money into this.
Clearly, everybody wants a vaccine as soon as possible. Jonathan, what about the political effects of this?
Well, what's unfortunate about what the administration is doing, I mean, great on the rapid testing, a vaccine coming before the election, not so sure about that. But it seems that all of these moves are being made not because of compassion for the sick and for the infected and for those who died, but as a political maneuver to shore up a political problem that the president has. He has not been handling the response to the coronavirus pandemic well at all. And I think what the American people have been looking for is, where is the national plan? What are you doing to safeguard our health? But by extension, safeguard our livelihoods, because the pandemic has hit us in our health, but it's also hitting us in the pocketbook and our livelihoods.
Finally, to both of you, this article that raised a lot of eyebrows that has just come out in The Atlantic overnight. David, Jeffrey Goldberg reporting from anonymous sources, but in his words, credible sources, that the president used words like suckers and losers over the course of his presidency, talking about people who served in the military, people who died in war. The White House completely denies this. Do you see something like this having an effect?
Yeah, I mean, Jeffrey Goldberg has had a whole series of scoops coming out of the Pentagon and the Defense Department and administrations going back for decades now, so he's a high credibility journalist. The story has now been confirmed by several other news organizations, including Fox News. And so we can fully expect that he dishonored the war dead by calling them losers and suckers. And it's not so far out of reach of what he said in public about John McCain and others. So I find it completely credible. And that the idea that a guy who is offended by Colin Kaepernick taking a knee, he says that dishonors the country, but calling the war dead losers, that's an absurdity. And so people are rightly offended. I mean, we get offended by this guy on an hourly basis, but this is an offense that goes to the core of conservative value system, the military value system. And what's been shocking to me this year is already, even before this happened, according to surveys of active military personnel, they were already for Biden, which is extremely rare for the active military to be for Democrats. And so he was already in trouble with this group, and it's got to trouble everybody who's in and out of uniform.
Jonathan, what are you thinking about this?
I didn't think I could be shocked anymore, particularly since Charlottesville, about what the president says or thinks about things or individuals. I was horrified by what I read attributed to the president of the United States, where Jeffrey Goldberg got based on four sources. And the fact that, to David's point, that it has been corroborated by other news organizations, including my own, the Washington Post, tells you something. And it is shameful. But I think what is even more shameful is the silence from Republican leaders around the nation and from Capitol Hill.
Tough subject, tough everything right now. It's hard to think of something uplifting. But we appreciate both of you. Thank you for being here, Jonathan Capehart, David Brooks.
Thanks.
Thank you.